Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S.Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues the series, The Final Part of the End Times. The millennium is coming to an end. The world's population has exploded in growth because there is no sickness or death. Resurrected believers have ruled the earth with Jesus until they are recalled at the end of the 1,000 years, because Lucifer is about to be released from the bottomless pit. When it happens, Satan wastes no time in organizing his forces to deceive the nations. The majority of the people change their allegiance to the devil, and a new world federation is established with Lucifer as their king. Factories retool and begin producing weapons and vehicles. Young men are drafted and trained in warfare by fallen angels. Then the devil gives the order to attack Israel and dethrone Jesus in Jerusalem. This message is entitled, The Final War. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Well, praise the Lord. We're going to be talking today about the final war. And if you want to have the Bible ready, turn to Revelation chapter 20. That's Revelation, the 20th chapter. And we're now moving up in time. We're about 980 years into the 1,000-year kingdom. The world population has exploded. There are now more than 100 billion people alive, and no one is showing their age. Some of them insisted on breaking the laws of the kingdom and died at the age of 100, but the vast majority lived for the entirety of the millennium. At this time, there's no shortage of food and water, as farmers plant and harvest 4 times a year, and the ground is never depleted of nutrients. Millions of people have settled on the continent of Antarctica, which has become one of the most beautiful places in the world. Each nation is ruled by a resurrected believer. The administration is also staffed by them, and Jesus does not allow any humans born during the millennium to hold a government job. The police consist of resurrected believers, and they also run the prisons where criminals are being held. This structure has become a source of contention for the regular humans who are not allowed to elect their own rulers. So we're having a time right now where everything is working perfect. There's almost no sickness. Everybody got a job. Everybody's well paid. Everybody got a nice place to live. They have vehicles to drive, vacation time, climate is perfect, no insects are biting them, all the animals are eating grass, and the whole world, so to say, is a petting zoo. You can go out and pet any animal you want to, and they just look at you with love and lick your hands. And simply says, I love you, can see it in their eyes. It's a perfect world. Do you know, human nature, we have a sinful nature. And we are not content. And people are simply beginning to grumble. You know, we're grown-ups. We are adults. We've been educated. We really should be able to have government jobs. We should be ruling ourselves. We should not have a police department of resurrected believers. We should have our own police. And so it is brewing. Now, 980 years in. Now we are down to 5 years left of the 1,000-year kingdom. And Jesus simply notifies every resurrected believer. That's you and I that are in chapel today and you that are watching. We are rulers at this time. We are in government jobs. And we get a notice. Catch the next flight to Jerusalem. It's pretty much the same thing as when we had a resurrection break out in different countries, like in Iraq. We had it in a number of other countries. And the first thing that happens is the American president gives the order to have the diplomats and all people that are American citizens to be flown out. You've seen that. And we have our military planes come in. They fly out our people because we know bad times are coming. And we simply want to protect our own people. But in this case, you and I have to be removed because we now do not have a sinful nature. We are like the angels. We don't lose our temper. We don't get mad. We don't get sad. We are very happy. And so Satan cannot tempt us anymore. We are immune, vaccinated. It's wonderful. And so Jesus says this, I have to pull you back because Satan is going to be loosed for just a little bit and tempt all the people living on earth that were born after the great tribulation and those children that made it in. Now, you and I know, we know it today, and we will know it then, that Lucifer is going to be set loose. We know that. So now as we are flying into Jerusalem, and we are settled in different places there. Now there are millions and millions of us. And these are all the believers in Christ. Now we're coming back to Israel. And we know this. The last war is about to begin. We will not be affected by it, but it will affect people that we have ruled. There's going to be some people that you ruled. You might have been a supervisor. You might have been a county commissioner. You might have been a mayor. You might have been a governor, different areas. You might have been ruling. And you have people that get to know you. You like them. And they were like children to you. And now you had to leave them. And you can't tell them why. You simply have to get up. And that's going to be hard for us, knowing that these people that we witnessed to, some of them loved Jesus, but they didn't get saved because they cannot be tempted until the end. Knowing that Satan is going to come and that the majority of them are going to select the devil. It's going to be hard for us. It's the same thing for parents today. You raise your child. You do the best you can. And I had one mother told me some time back, she said, you know, we only had one girl. And we raised her. We had her homeschooled. We did everything we could. And then this jerk came along when she was in her 20s and swept her off her feet. And she disappeared. And then he dumped her. And now we got damaged goods back. And here she is now, beat up. It hurts. Because you as a parent, you remember your teenage years. You remember the stupid thing you did. You remember the pain when things didn't work out. And you look at your child and you simply says, you know, please listen to me. I've been there. But you know, the human nature, sinful nature, this is what I told my parents. I simply said this, hey, you guys are stupid. Right now is 1950. We are advanced. We are in an advanced society. You guys are old-fashioned. We know better. As teenagers, we know everything. I remember that. And you know what? The older I got, the smarter my parents got. Until I got old enough, I realized, you know, Mom and Dad were pretty smart. You know why? Because they had made some mistakes. And they tried to help me not to make it. So we are now down there in Jerusalem. We read Revelation 27 right now. And when 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. Now ask yourself this question. Why did Jesus, 1,900 years ago, tell us what is going to happen? And the reason is, he doesn't want anyone to have an excuse and says, well, if I would have known that, I would have changed. What about Satan? He reads the Bible. He knows that this is going to happen. But why does he continue to do bad things? I don't have an answer to the Bible, but this is my personal conclusion. He simply knows that he's going to go to the lake of fire. He knows that God loves people. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes him should not perish but everlasting life. And Satan is simply thinking, if I can stack hell so full of people it's running over, God will change his mind and say, oh, we got too many people, billions of people in hell. I got to change. I got to give Satan a chance. That's what he's banking on. Because if you are a criminal and you've been arrested and you're out on bail, you're not going to be dumb and say, okay, I'm going to do some more crime. You don't want to add to your sentence. That's why it is happening. And this is what we as believers, as human beings, need to understand. 1 minute past midnight on the last day of 1,000 years. Jesus gave a command, and Lucifer is released from the bottomless pit. He flies out like a rocket, at the same time falling loose from the holding pens in the air. An untold number of evil spirits let out from their cages, and Satan barks of orders to set up his world government system again. Now he's out. He knows this is his last fling. He tells the fallen angels, we got to stack hell. This is our last chance. If we blow this, we're done. This is our last chance to have God to change his mind. And he simply says, be ruthless. Get after the people. So the devil orders his minions to seize the global television network. Now, we are pulled back. Satan has total freedom now. He moves in Africa. He moves in Europe, Asia, North and South America, Australia. He's moving everywhere. There's no resistance. All of us have been pulled back. Now, we're watching. On television, this is unfolding as we sit in Israel. Now, fallen angels begin to look like angels of light, and they are producing new programming. And Lucifer appears on television as a shining angel, and he tells the people of the world he has come to set them free from the bondage they've been under for 1,000 years. Look at the people today in the United States. I wrote a book a couple of years ago, maybe 3 years ago, called Bitter Fruit. And I'm really upset because I can't convey to people what I know, what will happen. There was one preacher today on national television, and he spent the entire program on repentance. And he simply said, the church has forgot history. Now, I'm trying to tell people, why don't you buy that book? Well, you know, it's not that thick, you know, but, you know, it doesn't, you know, I don't want to read that, you know. I'd rather have, you know, a Kindle book or want to watch television. But here's what happened. About 1830, the people of the world government, and the world government simply consists from generation to generation. They simply, when they die off, they have groomed people, so it continues the same way. And they simply said this, we cannot change the adults. They're set. We have to get the children. So they set out to organize a new set of education. And they created a secret society called the Order of Skull and Bones at Yale University. They only allowed 15 people per year to be initiated. You cannot be initiated. You are initiated the last year at Yale. Everybody knows about Skull and Bones. They got a place they call the tomb. You can't get in there, heavily guarded. And the students know that they're going to be knocking on our doors. So 15 men would get a call and simply say, hey, we would like for you to come and talk to us, to join Skull and Bones. And they promised them this, you join us, your future is going to be bright. We're going to grease the road for you. All we need you to do is to do what we tell you to do. 15 men have an initiation. They initiate it naked. They had to wrestle with one another in mud while the older Skull and Bone people are watching them. They have to homosexually, simply rape one another. It's simply a degrading. And this is what George H.W. Bush, he was a Skull and Bone, his son was. John Kerry, Democrat, the Skull and Bones. And if you look at America right now, you'll find that Skull and Bones members are scattered into banking, politics, industry, all the key places, including education. So now, they simply said, we need a new type of education. It really took place in 1960. But they simply said, you're going to have a secular nation and there can be no more prayer in public schools, no more Bible reading in public schools. That was the first thing to go. And then the next thing was in 1973, the Supreme Court said, now we mandate abortions. And then a number of years later, not too far ago, the Supreme Court said, now we're going to have homosexual marriages. And we've had one thing after the other. We've been going down on a slope like this to where we are today that everything goes. Now, the people you see today on the streets, They are the fourth and fifth generation of the new educational system and the skull and bones. They are told evolution, there's no God, there's no right, no wrong. We have situation ethics. And these people simply are have been destroyed, and they are like animals on a farm. On a farm, animals, you know, do whatever they want to do whenever they want to. And there's nothing holding them back. And this is what happened today. And this is what is happening now at the time of the end of the millennium. Let's read verse number 8 now. And shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. Here's what I want you to catch. We're going to have, I estimated there, about 200 million, actually 2 billion people. A lot of people. The majority of the people who have lived through the millennium, they have benefited from Jesus. They had the best life ever could have had. Perfect condition on the earth. As soon as Lucifer appears, they are bamboozled and go, wow! And Lucifer says now, on television, folks, I want to tell you this. As an angel of light, they see him shining, brilliant, beautiful. He says, now, I will give you the freedom that you need. If you really want to see that, look upon Joe Biden. He really got nothing to offer people. And he's not very charismatic. He got people pushing him behind. And he's going to do this, and he's going to do that, and we're going to do this, and we're going to have such a wonderful time. We're all going to be riding on the streets. I'm going to raise your taxes. I'm going to take your money away. You're going to have social medicine. And people say, wow, what a plan. I was in a store yesterday, and I hate that because I got an accent. And people say, where are you from? And I usually tell them, well, I used to live in Salt Lake City. Where did you live before that? So I said, I'm from Sweden. Oh. I said, now, I'm from the country of a wonderful social medicine. There's quite a few people in the store. They were listening. I said, now, in Sweden, if you got sick, you had to go to a regional hospital, might be 200 miles away. You have to first get permission to go to the hospital. If you're diagnosed with certain things, they say, okay, fine. It will be about 3 to 4 months before we can get to you. And if you're too old, they simply say, you cannot have surgery, you're too old, just go home and just sit down and wait for you to die. How do I know that? My dad, 70 years old, had cataract. He couldn't really see very bad. And he went to the regional hospital and said, I need cataract surgery. And they checked him out and they said, hey, man, you're too old. Just go home, die, man. That's what he was told. He was not in bad shape. My brother and I, we brought him and mom over here permanently. And the first thing we did was we had gave him a cataract surgery. At that time, it cost $5,000. And he was 2 days in the hospital. This is in the 80s. So he got both eyes fixed. Got a driver's license here. Drove around for a number of years. Had a great life. But under social medicine, he was too old. So why do they? What do they save money for? To waste it. Anyway, so I want you to go with me to 2 Corinthians, chapter 11. 2 Corinthians, chapter 11. And we're going to read these verses here. For verse number 13, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostle of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. Muhammad saw this angel of light, and today more than 1 billion people are worshiping Muhammad and their God. Joseph Smith saw this angel of light, and millions of Mormons are following him all the way to hell. So Lucifer is going to come up and he's going to say, now, we need to take down Jesus. Folks, let's think right now. If you say that you are a Christian, people look upon you and say, you want these right-wing Trump supporters? Don't you know that more people have been killed in the name of Christ than any other person? Christianity is not a good. Right now, we as Christians, we're not well thought of. The majority of the people in America today, the younger ones, don't like Christians. It's a spirit. Turn to Jeremiah 17:9. Jeremiah 17 and verse number 9. The heart is deceitful above all things, desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings. We have a sinful nature. Even if you're a Christian, you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, you still have a sinful nature. Our souls are wicked. They're filled with bad stuff. And when we are born again, we have the spirit, and we are supposed to take the spirit and control the soul. But you know and I know that there are times when we are not acting too Christian. And it comes out, and we need again to crucify ourselves in order for us to be able to control this flesh. So on television right now, you have now called to arms. And what they're doing now is they are simply continually saying right now, we need to dethrone Jesus. And they're going to have recruiting stations everywhere. Men and women signing up. We want to sign up. There's been no training for war for 1,000 years. And now, bases are open everywhere, all continents, men and women, basic training. Factories are running day and night, producing weapons. If you want to know how that's going to look like, let me take you back to 1943 in the United States. We had the War Act. The president gave order. Every factory, war production, Ford, General Motors, Chrysler, all of them, no cars were made. You will never find a car of 1943, 44, 45. They don't exist. They were making tanks, airplanes, ships, weapons, bombs. Every factory in the United States was simply on a war footing to produce enough arms to equip more than 12 million Americans to go and put down the Nazis and the Japanese. So this is what's going to happen here now. Every factory there working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Turn back to Ezekiel, now chapter 38. That's the book of Ezekiel, chapter 38. Now you're going to find that most Christians are talking about this war prior to the Great Tribulation. But this is the war that is describing the last war. Why did God simply tell Ezekiel some 580 years before Christ? He gave him a detailed report and said, this is how the war is going to be. Why did he do that? Because he wants us to know it. He wants the people at the time in the millennium to know it. They will be without excuse. Have you read enough from verse number 1? And the word of the Lord came to me saying, son of man, set your face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him. And say, thus says the Lord God, behold, I'm against you, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and I will turn your back and put hooks in your two jaws. I will bring you forth and all your army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company with bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords. Now, this was described, he saw this vision 2,500 years ago. He used the terms of that day. Persia, that's Iran, Ethiopia, that's Africa, Libya with them, all of them shielded helmet, Gomer and all his bands, that's Germany, Europe, the house of Togomora, those are the Scandinavian countries, of the North Quarters, all his bands, and many people with you. Be you prepared, and prepare for yourself, you and all your company that are assembled unto you, and be you a guard unto them. And the guard here is the prison guard. After many days, you shall be visited. In the latter years, you should come into the land that is brought back for the sword. It's gathered out of many people against the mountain of Israel, which has always been waste, but is brought forth out of the nations. And they that should dwell safely, all of them. That's a description of the millennium. You shall ascend and come like a storm. There were no airplanes at that time. You shall be like a cloud to cover the land, you and all your bands and many people with you. Thus says the Lord God, it shall come to pass that at the same time shall things come into your mind, and you shall think an evil thought. Look now in verse 11. And you shall say, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. Jeremiah, when he lived, Ezekiel, when he lived here, every city had a wall around it. There were no unwalled villages. I will go to them that are at rest, that dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls, having neither bars nor gates. A description of the future. To take a spoil, take a prey, to turn your hand upon the desolate places that are not inhabited, as upon the people that are gathered out of the nations, which are gotten cattle and goods that dwell in the midst of the land. Sheba and Dedan, the merchant of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof, shall say unto you, are you come to take a spoil? Have you gathered a company to take a prey? To carry away silver and gold, to take away cattle and goods, to take a spoil? Therefore, son of man, prophesy and say unto Gog, thus says the Lord God, in the day when my people of Israel dwell safely. Notice now, in that day when my people of Israel dwell safely, shall you not know it? There's no safety in Israel today. And you should come from your place out of the north parts, you and many people with you, all of them riding upon horses, a great company and a mighty army. And you should come up against my people of Israel as a cloud to cover the land. It shall be in the latter days that will bring against my land that the heathen may know me when I shall be sanctified in you, O Gog, before their eyes. Thus is the Lord God. Are you he of my spoken old time of my servant, the prophet of Israel, which prophesied in those days, many years, that I would bring you against them? So people now are being trained. Ships are being built again. Navy ships, airplanes, crafts, spacecraft, all kind of things. And they're simply working hard to bring down upon the time of Jesus there. You and I are going to be in Jerusalem. We're going to see all of this on our screens because there's going to be satellites up there that's going to show this to us. Now, by this time, every human on earth has had to make a decision to stay with Jesus or side with Lucifer. There will be people that you and I have been with for 1,000 years. And we told them about Jesus. And we told them, this day is coming. And they will simply say, when I see Lucifer on television, they're going to say, no. I'm going to make a choice. I'm going to choose Jesus. And that's when they are going to be saved. How many people are going to be saved? We don't know. But we know this. The majority will go with Lucifer as the sand of the sea. Look upon America right now. We're about 350 million people or so. Do you realize that most of these people will reject Jesus? Most of these people living today will end up in hell as a lake of fire. Do you realize the privilege that, first of all, you were born in this country? Secondly, you heard the gospel. Thirdly, you were given the gift of repentance. You accepted Christ and were born again. You are one in a minority. Do you realize 1 billion Muslims are heading for hell? They died for years. They stacked in hell with them. You got the Hindus in India, the Buddhists, Japan, China, many other places, people in Africa, South America, all your Roman Catholics, all your Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, group after group after group. And you were selected, given the gift of repentance, and saved. And you know what? We don't appreciate it. Every day, you should get up and say, thank God I was not born in Saudi Arabia. Thank God I was not born in Japan. Thank God I was not born in India. Thank God I heard the gospel. Thank God, Jesus, for the gift of repentance. The first thing we need to do as Christians is to be thankful and not think about, well, I don't have enough money, I don't have this, I don't have that. You got everything. Let's be thankful. In less than 3 years, a war machine is built, and Lucifer gave the order to start moving the troops toward Israel. The battle. Now, Jesus knows that this is coming. He's allowing this because he wants people really to make a decision. Is this what I want? He's going to allow the forces of Lucifer to come close. They're going to take Syria. They're going to take Egypt. They're going to take Jordan. They're going to take everything in that area. And they're going to go for the final assault. And that's when Jesus is going to say, enough is enough. You and I will be there. We will hear this. When Jesus gives the order to Michael, the archangel, he simply said this, attack. At that moment, all hell is going to break loose. You're going to see crafts of war coming down from outer space. They're going to swoop down. They're going to shoot down and clean down every craft that Satan had built and had his pilots do. It's going to be a slaughter. When that wave has gone and cleaned the air, now comes the next wave. It'll be gunships. Like we see in the 8-10, you have a gunship that goes down and just laid down fire. They're just horrible. But these have particle beams, laser weapons, and they're going to sweep over, and they're going to kill every, incinerate every soldier. Young men and women are going to realize, they're going to see the ships coming down, and at that moment they're going to realize, I made a wrong choice. But you know, it's too late. Too late. And they get incinerated, and they're gathered up, taken to hell. Let's read from verse number 18 in Ezekiel 38. It shall come to pass at the same time when Gog shall come against the land of Israel, says the Lord God, that my fury shall come up my face. For in my jealousy and the fire of my wrath have I spoken. Surely in that day there shall be a great shake in the land of Israel. So the fish of the sea, the fowls of heaven, the beasts of the field, and all creeping things that creep on the earth, and all the men that are upon the face of the earth, shall shake in my presence. The mountains shall be thrown down, the steep places shall fall, and every wall shall fall to the ground. And I will call for a sword against him throughout all my mountains, the Lord God, every man's sword against his brother. And I will plead against him with pestilence, with blood. I will rain upon him, upon his bands, and upon the many people that are with him, and overflowing rain and great hailstone, fire and brimstone. Thus will I magnify myself, sanctify myself, and I will be known in the eyes of the nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord. It's going to be a tremendous slaughter. Turn to Revelation 29 right now. Revelation 29. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about the beloved city. And fire came down from God of heaven and devoured them. People now, by the millions, the people that were in the armed forces, they're dead. the people that made a choice to worship Lucifer will now be collected by God's holy angels. I want you to hear this now. These angels will come up to these men and women and simply say this: you made a choice for Satan. We're not going to execute you. I'm going to take you to hell. You're done. Can you imagine you stepping out of your house to go to work in the morning? As you go down the garage ramp to get your car, there's an angel tapping on the shoulder. He says, "What?" And he says, "You made a choice for Lucifer. I'm going to kill you right now. And I'm going to take your soul to hell." How do you think people are going to react? It's going to be a shock. I mean, people are going to, at that time, they're going to say, "Wait a minute, it can't happen." But it will happen. Here we are. We haven't got into the 1,000-year yet. We haven't got into the great tribulation yet. And I'm warning people. Tomorrow, some of you that are watching might be dead. You might have a car accident. You might have a heart attack. You might be gone, but we have a webcast next week. We don't know when you go. And so I'm warning people, make sure you got your life insurance for eternity. Do it now. Don't wait. For years, I talked to my wife about the need to set up a living trust, a will. And she said, "I don't want to talk about death." I said, "We need to do that. Because if we don't have a living trust, the state is going to come in. And we're going to have a stupid judge make a decision what to do with our property. Nah, I won't hear about it." Finally, I was able to convince her we should do it. And we had it drawn up. We had it signed with a notary. We recorded it with the county recorder's office. And 3 weeks later, she could not even sign a name. Alzheimer's took over very quickly. And it was the last moment that we did it. That's the same thing with you. If you haven't accepted Christ, today is the day to do it. Because you don't know tomorrow. Now, as people are being killed off, taken to hell, processed in hell, we have special angels. And this time, they're locating Lucifer. This time, they are not nice. They're simply grabbing a hold of that scumbag. And they're saying, "You had it. This is the end of your ride." They will shackle him. They will put him on a spaceship. They will fly him outside the universe where the lake of fire is in a closed system. They will land, give him to the angels that are running that, and there he will be taken. And then he will be taken to his place. I believe we're going to see that on television. And I'm going to read this. I said it many times. The day I see on TV the devil being held over, and as they lower him into the lake of fire, and I hear the, I'm not going to use the B word, but I'm going to say the scumbag, being lowered and screaming pain, I'm going to go, glory to God, give it to him. As we see the angels, fallen angels lowered. As you see the demons that made you sick, that destroyed your marriage, that made you an alcoholic, that made you a dope addict, you couldn't stop smoking, you couldn't stop vaping, you're going to see those demons, and you're going to rejoice when they are put down, just like to have a lobster thrown into boiling water and turning red as he's that comes down in that hot water. What a day that will be. The end of Lucifer, his fallen angels, and all evil spirits. Now here comes the good news. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians. And this is something that you probably have not thought of or heard of. So we go to 1 Corinthians. Chapter 6. Let me pick it up here. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 through 3. Dare any of you having a matter against the Lord to go to law before the unjust and not before the saints? Do you not know that the saints shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the small matters? Know you not that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? Before the fallen angels are thrown in there, there's going to be like a grand jury or a jury like we have today. And we're going to sit in that jury box. And all of us believers, we're going to be scattered all over the earth. There's going to be a lot of angels to judge. And they're going to bring them in. And they're going to show us what they have done. And you and I will have the power. You see, in a lake of fire, it's bad. But in the lake of fire are degrees of torment. Probably millions of different degrees. And you and I will sit to that jury box. We will see that fallen angel come in. We will see what he has done in his life. And then we're going to judge him. We're going to say, well, we're going to give him the 375th degree. And the judge will say, done. Take him away. Stack him where he belongs. Do you realize? You and I go to judge angels, fallen angels. You would have that opportunity. Every demon, the kingdom of Satan, is scooped up and flown to the lake of fire. Now, this is the bonus scripture here. I want you to turn to Luke chapter 9. The Gospel of Luke chapter 9. And I want to ask you questions today. We read in Luke 9, verse number 23. And Jesus said to them, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. For what man is advantageous to gain the whole world and lose himself be cast away? For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come in his own glory and his Father's and of the holy angels. So where are you at in your personal life? Are you ashamed of Jesus? Or are you simply saying, I am not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed of Jesus. Look at the last verse 62 in that chapter. Luke chapter 9, verse 62. And Jesus said to him, no man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Most of you are city dwellers. In the early days, and I'm old enough that I remember trying this out. I was on a farm. We had a farm when I didn't have a farm, but we went to vacation time when I was a boy. And they would have a horse, two horses, and they would have a plow. And the guy would simply start this end of the field. He would get a hold of a tree down there. He would not look on the ground. He would look on that tree. He would hold the reins. And then it would say, okay, go. And the horse would take off. He focused on that tree and go all the way down. And then you have a straight line. If you do it and you look back like this, you're going to go like this. So Jesus simply says, don't get tied up in things around you. Keep your focus on me and finish. And then I'm going to finish with Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. And I want to ask you a question on this one. That's Romans chapter 6. If you read from verse number 12, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield your members as instrument of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourself unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instrument of righteousness to God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law but under grace. What then shall be sin because you are not under the law but under grace? God forbid. Know you not that to whom you yield yourself servants, the Greek word here is slave. Know you not that whom you yield yourself slaves to obey. His slaves you are to whom you obey, whether sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness. In deliverances, we simply are telling people that, you know, you have to clean up your life. Now, the average person, and this is just in generality, they are hooked either on sex, they are hooked on alcohol, they are hooked on other drugs, they hook on nicotine. It can be smoking cigarettes or vaping. Actually, a vapor is more hooked than a guy that smokes cigarettes. And masturbation, I mean, pornography, it's a plethora out there of things we're hooked on. And as we talk to people, they say, well, I just can't give it up. I'm too weak. I just can't give it up. And I'm simply telling them this. And I'm telling you right now, you're either here, you're either watching. If you have any vice that you say, I just can't give it up, here's the real deal. Jesus is not Lord in your life. That thing, that demon, is a worship demon. And Satan is the Lord of your life. You must say, well, I'm saved. I'm baptized. I go to church. If you have a demon that you worship, don't lie to yourself, lie to anyone else. Just simply say this. Yes, I'm a backsliding Christian, and I worship Satan because I'm too weak. And let me ask you this. If you cannot get off whatever you are, what are you going to do when they got the mark of the beast? And you're told, hand over your car keys. Hand over your house keys. Give us your wallet. Walk on the street. Get out. You're homeless. Get lost. You don't take the mark, you're done. Your wife is screaming, oh, you can't do that because how are we going to do with our medication? How are we going to do with this and that? Hey, you got to comply. Yeah. A lot of Christians will comply. If you cannot say no to sin now, you're not going to say no to the mark of the beast. You should tremble right now and simply realize what I'm telling you is truth. Because if you take the mark of the beast, you cannot change. You cannot say a moment after you take it, I'm sorry, I should have done this. You're done. Toast. You understand that? Toast for eternity. The question is this. Who do you worship? Don't try to sing this song. He is Lord. He is Lord. If you got anything else that you are worshiping, how do you get loose from that? You got to get angry. You got to get angry and simply say, I'm done. I'm not going to be ruled by Satan anymore. But you know what? Most of you don't have the guts to be angry. You're like overboard spaghettis, flopping around in the air, left and right, and saying, well, you know, make up your mind. Jesus expects you. Yes is yes. No is no. Don't think you can ride any longer. So look at your outline on the left, what we had on two things. Remember, it is not so important how you begin your life after salvation, but how you finish. As long as there's breath, you haven't taken the mark of the beast, you can't repent. And so let me ask you this. If you that are watching today, you are not saved, would you today give your heart to Christ? Would you say, Father God, forgive my sins. I'm sorry I have sinned. I ask you right now, Lord, save me. I believe in Jesus. I believe he's the Son of God. He died on the cross, rose on the third day. Come on and save me, Jesus. You do that today, you will be saved. When we finish here, the screen will change. When you're watching, you will see three crosses coming up. And you will hear the soothing voice of Pastor Charles Terrell saying, my friend, and then he will lead you for a few minutes into salvation, show you scriptures, and pray with you, and you can be saved today. So when we finish here, stay with it and pray with Pastor Charles. And then write us, call us. We'd like to rejoice with you. And to those of you that are saved, I know that today some of you says, I'm not going to send any more money down to him. He's just too hard. He condemned me. Well, that's fine. If that's what you want to do, that's your problem, not my problem. But if you are listening and you realize I hit the smack between the eyes today, why not repent? Get up and get mad at the devil and turn to Christ and change your way of living. May God bless you. Here's Brother Thomas.
I thank you for the Word of God that we opened up here this morning. And it is never disappointing to get into the Word of God. And I'm hooked on the Word of God. So I thank you for the Word. I thank you for not only the Word, but the ability to have it opened up to us and to be able to understand it. Because as your word says, those that don't have eyes to see or ears to hear, it's foolishness to them. But to us, it is a great reward. So we thank you for the Word of God. We thank you for our many blessings. And like Pastor John preached, we all need to be thankful. Thankful, thankful. I thank you for the way you have blessed me and mine. And I thank you for knowledge, wisdom, and understanding is priceless in this day and age. And we lift up the situation in the United States of America and in the world. We know that deception is the name of the game. And I pray that their eyes will be open to see exactly what's going on. And I thank you for helping us to navigate through all the lies and deception. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that You would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in You. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that You paid for my sins on the cross through Your shed blood, and that You died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank You for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with You. Help me to be obedient and to walk with You. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Terrell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You have been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Terrell. This message was the second part in the series, the final part of the end times, and was entitled, The Final War. The millennium is coming to an end. The world's population has exploded in growth because there is no sickness or death. Resurrected believers have ruled the earth with Jesus until they are recalled at the end of the 1,000 years, because Lucifer is about to be released from the bottomless pit. When it happens, Satan wastes no time in organizing his forces to deceive the nations. The majority of the people change their allegiance to the devil, and a new world federation is established. Factories begin producing weapons, and young men are trained in warfare. When this massive army surrounds Jerusalem, Jesus declares the process of proving God's righteousness is over, and orders Michael to attack the Luciferian army. As lightning from heaven, thousands of spaceships dive toward the earth, raining destruction and death upon Satan's forces. The devil's reign of terror comes to an end when he is captured and cast into the lake of fire. The angels that joined his rebellion also suffer the same fate. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1773. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.